Hello and welcome to Mid-American Gardener. We are the show that you get to hear your questions answered, and we talk about plants all the time. We love it. So I am here and two professionals, and we're going to talk about a lot of fun things that's going on in the garden right now. I'm Dianne Noland, and I teach horticulture at the University of Illinois in the Crop Sciences Department. So I'll answer questions about cut flowers or perennials, but let's find out who's here, and we're going to see what their expertise is as well. So I'm going to introduce first Kent Miles.
Thanks, Dianne. My name is Kent Miles. I'm from Illinois Willows. We are a specialty cut flower grower in western Champaign County. We primarily grow all types of flowers, annuals, perennials, woody ornamentals, and we offer them in the wholesale trade, retail, and farmers markets. We have an email question that was sent in, and it's about clustered bell flower. And the caller email says, I have a patch of this flower that has gotten out of control. I've tried everything to kill it, weed killer, salt, bleach, and nothing's getting rid of it. It has taken over the entire garden. Can you please make suggestions for ridding myself of this problem? It appears the roots grow and allow the spreading. This particular, in the photograph now, is the clustered bell flower. There's several different varieties. Some are low, which would be suitable for a rock garden. And then there's others that was pictured, which we grow as a cut flower, and they get up to about 28 inches in height. It's a campanula, and it will spread and send up rhizomes for establishing new plants and spreading. It's a zone 3-8 plant, so that fits right in with us. If you aren't necessarily afraid of using Roundup and other weed killers, I would suggest Roundup and or a brush killer. You want to spray the application on a non-windy day and protect the flowers and shrubbery that's around this area so it doesn't drift onto those special items you have. One other choice, alternative might be to lay black plastic over the area, weight it down. This summer would be a good time to do it right now when it's getting warmer. The warmer temperatures will help kind of bake it off, and you'll kill any type of weed, grass that could be growing up in that area. I would leave it on probably all the way through most of midwinter. Take it off in the spring, see what's still growing, if anything. If you're still starting to see a little emergence of the bell flower, I would just hit it with probably one more application, and that should probably take care of it.
I know in the garden I have it in, daylilies hold their own.
Mm-hmm.
I have the really tall ornamental grass, it holds its own, so it maybe just has galloped over.
Mm-hmm.
If anything's left, leave a little batch. I really like it as a cut flower. I just think it's really
pretty. It's really pretty because it blooms in the clusters in the different levels.
But ours if you're not paying attention,
right. Ours this year isn't blooming. We haven't got one blossom yet.
Oh,
so,
wouldn't you know it?
But we've got a lot of grass planted in that area, so it's kind of choking it out.
Competing.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so maybe if you do plant it with things that can take it.
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
Well, that was a great question, and thank you for your email, and Kent for the answer. All right, let's go to the guy in the middle, Kai Zatarani.
All right. Hi, I'm the guy in the middle, a.k.a. Kai Zatarani. I wear different hats. I'm the program director and a professor in the horticulture and landscape design department at Parkman College, and also a part-time faculty at the College of Aces at the University of Illinois. And so I enjoy sharing some of the things related to design and plants. And what I have right now is actually one of the first viewers' questions is with regards to forsythia. How low can you go with a forsythia bush? First of all, it's important that you understand in today's day and age with all the different things with cultivars, we have your standard forsythia, which can get pretty tall and rambunctious. And without assuming that that's the one you're talking about, I'll mention a little bit about that too. Then there's another one, there's a different cultivar with a compact or a dwarf forsythia, as they call it. Back to the standard forsythia, there's several methods. In fact, Dianne and I were joking about this earlier, that like forsythia and deutzia, sometimes you can cut it down very low to the ground and you're not going to kill it. It will come back. The other way, for those of you who are a little cautious, you can do the rule of thirds. So every year you take it down about a third, and forsythia will come back. So not to worry. The dwarf ones, you want to be a little bit careful. You don't want to take out too much, but you can selectively, or as I like to say, judiciously prune it. So absolutely can be done, and you're not going to hurt it.
And this is a good time of the year because it's after flowering.
After flowering, that's another great rule. After the blooming is done, don't do it early in spring before they bloom, because then you're going to forego the buds. But right now, perfect timing. So.
Well, yeah. I had to trim my deutzia, which it would work for forsythia, because 2 years ago it was perfectly in flower and it got frosted. So then all of these dead branches were in here. And this past spring, I forgot to do it last year, and it really looked raggedy, because it had dead in with, and so there's no way to trim it out and then stay sane. So I just cut it all the way back,
happens.
And it makes you feel good too, because it looks good. Very good, thank you for that. And let's go next to our Did You Know section.
Broccoli was introduced to the U.S. by Italian immigrants, but did not become popular until the 1920s.
Okay, let's go on to the phone lines now and see what Bob has for us. It's line two, and he has a question about a maple. Hi, Bob.
Okay, I'm having some stuff done on my ash tree, and if I lose it, I've been recommending to put a autumn blaze maple. It's called Acer Fremania. Are you familiar with that?
Yes, with maples, especially given the gorgeous colors that you have now in fall, there's several cultivars or cultivated varieties. Autumn Blaze happens to be one, October Glory, and I'm sure there's quite a few. It's a good variety of maple. I mean, what specifically did you want to know about it, Bob?
I just want to know if that's a good tree to replace, if I have to get rid of one of my ash trees, replace it with that Autumn Blaze maple.
I would say so, unless, I mean.
Be a good choice.
Yeah, and great fall color, like I said, and certainly.
And they grow a little faster. You know, some people talk about oaks, but they grow a little faster than that. So. Yes, that's going to be the question, what to replace some of the ash tree with.
Oh, yes, quite a few.
Yes, thank you very much, Bob, for your question. Let's go on to Sandra's question on line three about trumpet vine. Hi, Sandra.
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome.
I'm having trouble getting rid of a trumpet vine.
Oh, that's for sure.
You too?
It's growing everywhere.
Yes.
And I have to be careful because it's coming up now through my roses. And I thought I killed the original trumpet vine, but evidently I didn't get it all, because it's coming up through my garden, my roses, and I can't spray them because I don't want to kill the roses.
Right. Right. I mean, when you try to get rid of it, did you just cut it down to the roots, or did you try and, I mean, that's...
I tried to dig out the original.
Dig out,
one.
Okay.
Evidently, I didn't get it all.
It may have stimulated some
more
other
growth.
Root growth.
Yeah.
Now, anything that's coming up, you can do a wick or paint the leaf of it without getting spray. But you can spray one leaf and the trumpet creeper will come up below that with another leaf. Mm-hmm. So it's probably going to be a lifelong passion of yours now. I hate to be pessimistic, but it's my worst weed, and I've never planted trumpet creeper.
Right.
Give her some better advice than what I just did, but it's long term.
Yeah, I think just maybe with a little hand sprayer,
right?
We could do that.
Right, or brush it on.
Or brush it on.
Right.
Would be the choices.
Or both.
Yeah.
You may want to find out, get some brush killer, go a little bit heavier, or is more concentrated.
Without getting on your roses.
Right.
It's a tough one, but just being careful might be your best solution.
And I mean, you can even put, you know, something behind it.
Right, as you hit it.
I use pizza boxes, but anyway, you know, something so that you don't get it on what you want not to spray. Well, wow, you're going to stay out of trouble, Sandra, because that is going to be quite, but you're not alone. You're not alone, yeah. So if that's any consolation. Thank you for your question. And let's go to Betty's question on line four about floating row covers. Hi, Betty.
Yes, hi. Last week or the week before, you talked about using the lightweight floating row covers on squash.
That's right.
To keep the squash vine borer mm-hmm. off. Well, I got some floating row cover. It said, I ordered it online, it said that it would be porous to watering, because I don't have a drip irrigation system, but it seems to bead up on this, so I have to pull the cover back to water.
Have you looked at it after a rain too? Because it's porous and it will just drip down through.
Well, it hasn't rained, and I've had to just water a couple of times.
I see.
But I have the question of how long does it have to stay on, and when will the moth go away? So I can take it off.
Let me give a comment about squash before we go on. If you have floating row cover over squash, you need to have one that's self-pollinating or self-fertile. And there are several types, so it doesn't need outside insects. And so you want to make sure that, you know, if you're taking it off to water, you probably are getting it pollinated. But it may not pollinate if you don't have a variety that's self-pollinating. Okay, so what else should we tell her about floating row cover and squash?
I haven't used it with squash.
Okay.
Well, yeah. I've used it multiple times and it works really well. And I just didn't, you know, I watered through it and it didn't seem to be a problem. Mm. But rain does a better job because it's slower and more subtle. But I have watered through it. Now, maybe you could. But if you have to take it off, you'd only have to take it off from one side mm-hmm. and put it right back in. So I would not take the whole thing off, but just a little bit and then come back. But I grew the best cabbage ever with floating row cover and the best squash. Mm-hmm. It was really impressive. And you can do broccoli.
It's a great concept. I mean, it works,
anything that doesn't, you don't want to get those little insects on. Okay, well, hopefully we'll get some rain and you'll get some nice dripping down through the floating row cover. But it's meant to have water come down through it. It's not as impervious to water as it appears.
Right.
And it shades in those hot days, too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's got a lot of good qualities. Okay, thank you, Betty. I hope we helped you on that one. Let's go to line five and Jane's question about eggplant. Hi, Jane.
Hi. That question before was just right. What I was asking about, I'm growing eggplant under floating row cover.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And frankly, the water comes through great. I don't have to take it off to water or anything like that. So, and they look beautiful, but my question is, when do I have to take that off to let the eggplant grow? I looked under it today and there's a couple blossoms. Do I need to pull the row cover now?
I haven't grown eggplant under it, but...
I don't think, you think it might be a little premature to take it out right now?
Are they self-pollinating? I'm not.
I've grown things in this family of eggplant, but not eggplant itself.
Yeah. Now, if I might ask, because my experience with eggplant, I've grown the Asian eggplants or the Chinese eggplants, the longer ones, compared to like what I would call the Italian or the European eggplant. Mm-hmm. Which ones do you have?
I have the...
Regular eggplant. Yeah, I don't have much experience with those.
Well, if you
I could tell you how to cook them, but yeah.
If you want to experiment, you could just leave it on, and if those first blossoms don't pollinate, you're going to know right away. But then you get the flea beetles if you leave it off.
Yeah,
so
it's one of those.
I would experiment, and you know, you'd only lose a few fruits, and over the whole course of a summer.
Oh, you'll have plenty,
You know, that maybe will keep you from looking like an eggplant after you've eaten that many. With floating row cover, it'll be effective, I think. So try and experiment and see if they do pollinate those first few fruits. Yes. Oh, well, that's fun. The floating row cover is catching on. Well, let's do one more. I see it's about a lilac on line six. Hi.
Hi. I've got a reblooming lilac, and I need to trim it, and... blooming again, so when do I trim it?
I was going to say yes. I'd say if it's blooming for the second time, right?
Yes.
It sounds like it would be right after flowering.
Yeah.
As soon as it finishes off, I would go ahead and start pruning it back.
I know you may not grow the re-blooming ones, but give him some hints if he wants to bring any of them in as a cut flower. What do you do on your lilacs?
Once they start to color up the flower cluster, you can, you get a few of the blossoms that are open, about a third to a half. You go ahead and cut them, and you can bring them into the home and use them for as a cut flower for your enjoyment.
Yeah, they're so wonderful, yeah.
Okay, well, we've got a lilac question in, so next, let's go back to our panelists, and I'll have you start us, Kent, doing another email.
All right. Email, this one is, a friend found a flower shown in her garden when it appeared and bloomed 1 year. She had no idea what it is. She gave us the plant, and it has been reliable in appearing every year, and it has spread. It is one of my favorite flowers, but we have unable to identify it. Any chance the panel knows what it is? It isn't in any wildflower books. Well, when I received this email, I looked at the photograph and I had a couple choices. So I had enlarged the photo to get a better look at the blossom and the foliage. And it turns out to be a Missouri evening primrose. Mm-hmm. And it's a perennial, and it's in fits in our zone here, 5 to 8. And it's a low growing, usually 4 to 6 inches in height. It opens in late afternoon through the evening, and it is pollinated by insects, and mainly moths will pollinate it. So after the blossoms have faded, after a period of a couple, usually it's almost blooms for almost a month or closer up to frost, and it'll set its seeds. So after the seeds have set, you can either go ahead and collect the little seed pods and distribute them in other areas of your garden if you'd like. But it is a perennial, and it will self-seed. Mm-hmm. So it generally spreads that way.
Yeah. Okay. Nice. That's interesting about the moth pollinating.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. A lot of nighttime insects will pollinate.
So 4 o'clock and mm-hmm. things that open up then.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
Thank you, Kent. Mm-hmm. And now Kaizad.
All right. Well, the question I have is with regards to boxwoods. Can boxwood be planted on the west side of the house with full afternoon sun? And this one, with full authority, or some authority, I can say, yes, I myself have a whole, I wouldn't call them a hedgerow, I've done a little design in front of my house that faces full sun on the west side. Initially, yes, make sure you do keep them watered. Now, in our area, our zone, they're considered a broadleaf evergreen, but they do come back. They're great. The only thing, and I love boxwoods, the only thing, just as a caution, you need to understand that if you walk past boxwoods and you get this smell like a dog has been in there doing his business, that's the odor that comes from boxwoods a lot of times when they're wet. So
I have never heard it described as
that. I mean,
that.
That's the best, because the first time I planted them, I said, God, there's dogs going in our boxwoods. and you can do all kinds of things. Mine, I have not trimmed. I have not done an Edward Scissorhands on them. I just like to leave them natural.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got the green velvet variety. So wonderful plants. I mean, I would certainly say, yeah, you should not have a problem.
Yeah. Okay, very good. That is an interesting way of describing boxwood. I guess it's more than just pungent.
Yes, it is. Okay. Yeah, pungent would be the more, yes.
That's what came to mind for me. But
malodorous.
Yes.
In the springtime, they flower.
Yes.
And that, I think, is a very pleasant smell.
Yes.
I have
been
going up my sidewalk, and you always notice it.
And it's probably one of the first thing honeybees go to.
Yes.
That's how early they are.
Yeah.
So it starts the season.
Mm-hmm.
It's really interesting. So thanks for bringing that up, too.
Yes.
That's good.
We got
it's
the
a dual.
Positive.
That's right.
Many things going on there. All right. Let's go to Sharon's question on line two about a dogwood. Hi, Sharon. Oh, we miss Sharon. Anyway, let's go to a hosta question on line three. Is it Sarita?
Yes.
Hi.
I have a question. I had a nice little garden of hostas a few years ago, and then over the winter, they disappeared. Not a one of them came back. And the same thing happened to me last year. I had a little row up next to a building, and I kept waiting for them to come up. They never came up. So do you know what? Is it a vole could eat them?
Do you have a rabbit problem?
We do have a lot of rabbits. We live out in the country. But will they get down and eat the roots?
I wouldn't, unless it's one of those drastic winters. I don't think they'll get down to the roots, but they will get to the tops. I mean, the foliage, that's like salad greens. I've lost some hostas. I love hostas, have quite a few, and lost a few to rabbits. I mean, you hear about slugs on hostas, but yeah, I mean, and your entire hosta population has been decimated?
Pardon me?
You've lost?
Yeah, the whole thing was gone.
Did you ever see digging?
No, it was just like they disappeared.
It's hard to kill hostas, really, once they're in the shade. And
right.
That happened to me two times.
Unless it's like deer nibbling them down.
No, they never came up. You know, spring when they're supposed to be coming up, they didn't come up.
I mean, the only thing I can think of is it's an animal issue eating at them because
to
I don't think...
To take the whole thing.
Whole thing,
I would probably dig around and see if there's anything under the ground.
Left. Yeah, check for the roots, because if your roots are in there, I mean, they're wonderful. They're very hardy. They will come back, but yeah.
Yeah, because it was not hardiness issues the last two years.
No, definitely not.
I wouldn't think. Really bad. You'll have to get some friends to give you hostas again, so with your experiment, it won't be expensive. And once people have hostas, they have
some
to
share.
Yes, they do. Well, thank you for that. I hope that you can get to the bottom of that. Okay, let's go to line 4 and Sue's question about salvia.
Hi there. I have deadheaded my first bloom of salvia, and it's bloomed again. Mm-hmm. Now, if I keep deadheading, will it keep blooming?
It should. May not be as robust as the first one or two rounds, but you should get blossoms throughout until frost.
Right.
But it's not as exciting.
Correct.
But,
right. And
but
not
it's worth
and not
it.
As full.
Right. Right.
Probably not as large the blossoms, but it'll be intermittent here and there. Mm.
But it's well worth it because I actually like the green tops of them before they turn brown. I get them out before they turn brown. Okay, thank you for your question. Now we have found Sharon. She's got a dogwood question, and let's go to line 6. Hi, Sharon.
Hi, Dianne. It's so glad to talk to you, and I'm glad I was able to get back on.
Great.
Because I wanted to call you every time. I have a 5-year-old dogwood. The third year it had one blossom, the fourth year it had two, and this spring it had one again. It's the large white blossom. Mm-hmm. There's one in the neighborhood, and it's always full, but it's an older tree.
Is the exposure? What is it
facing? East, west, or?
Pardon me?
What direction does it face? Where is it located?
It faces east.
Oh, that's good.
That is a good, yeah. And how old would you say this is?
Five.
It's five.
Okay, 5 years. That's not, should not be... age issue.
Do you get a lot of wind through there? Is there a wind tunnel or?
No, I don't think so. And the houses are all in a row and about the same distance from the road. And two houses from me, there is the yard that has two coral ones, and they bloom very nicely every year. I can't understand it.
And the buds
the big blossoms.
Right, but do you see early spring? I mean, do the buds come out? Do you see buds or there's no buds? Okay.
No.
So you're having,
probably some issues with the winter.
Fertilizing
and vigorousness.
Right.
As far as the tree itself.
Right.
You know, I do give trees about 5 years to prove that they should be taken out. That sounds kind of harsh, but. But you know your street can grow them, unless there's something about the
just
spot
a pocket,
that you put it.
Yeah, where you're at.
And that's unless you had another place to put it and see if the one will shame the first one into flowering. But and I'm just joking, really. but not joking about putting it another one in, because it really should.
Yeah,
it sounds like you've
got
a perfect street for it. Can you think of anything else that... Because you're not pruning, because there's nothing growing. It just sounds like it's limping along.
Yeah.
and there's so many better things to put in there,
right.
or at
right.
least another one in another spot. But they either do well or they seem they like just, they
yeah.
languish.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
is that harsh?
No, but no, that's a practical, yeah.
So anyway, that might not be good news for you, Sharon, but try a new one or a new spot, not in the same spot, I mm-hmm. would say.
Yeah.
And it could have been the plant that you bought. I mean, there could have been a girdling root in it. You never,
yeah,
know.
Never know.
It could have been actually the plant you got. So, well, and then report back to us. Well, we had all kinds of good questions, lots of nice tree questions. Thank you, too, for being here.
Thank you.
I want to thank each of you for watching. We are so glad to be able to talk about plants. And we will see you next time. See you then. Bye-bye.